And welcome to Visitors Chapel AME Church, where our pastor is the Reverend Jack D. Fields Sr. We want to thank you for being with us on today. We realize that you have many choices in this age of technology, but we are grateful and thankful that you have decided to unite with us on today. Now, you're going to hear a powerful word from on high. The pastor has some special announcements on some things that are going to take place on next Saturday and next Sunday. And after the singing of our song of sermon preparation, then you'll hear from our pastor, the Reverend Jack D. Fields Sr. God bless you as we listen to God in song.
I had a witness tonight. Said he saw the best in me. I guess I'm the only one got this testimony. When everyone else around me could only see the worst in me. Can I tell y'all one more time? I said he saw the best in me. When could only see the worst in me. I wish I had a witness tonight. All I need is one.
Hey! He saw the best in me.
When everyone else around me, yeah.
When everyone else around
me, could only see
the worst in me.
Does anybody have that testimony? When fuck walked you off, said you would never make it, what did he see?
Saw the best in me.
When everyone else around me asked,
could only see the worst in me.
Can I tell y'all one more thing? I just need to tell you one more thing. Listen to this. See, he's mine, and I am his. It doesn't matter what I do. He only sees me for who I am. Does anybody know that tonight? See, he is mine and I am his. Said it doesn't matter what I did. See, he only sees me for who I am. I had a witness tonight. That may be somebody else's testimony. Help me say it, help me say it.
He saw the best in me.
Everyone else around me.
When everyone else around could only see the worst in me.
Can I ask y'all one question? The question is simply this. What did he see?
He saw the best.
I can't get no help up in here. Because there are some folk in here that people have wrote you off. Said you would never amount to anything. Said that you would never end up being anywhere. But Myron, tell him one more time. What did he see?
He saw the best.
When mama said you would never be nothing. When aunties and uncles said that you'd never amount to anything. When daddy didn't come home anymore. He didn't look at you and say that you weren't going to make it. God looked at you and what did he see? What did he see?
He saw the best.
Yeah, yeah. Is there anybody in here tonight that's so very thankful that God did not write you off, that he did not throw you away, that he picked you up?
Let the church say amen. Let the church say amen again. Amen. God is good and all the time. Come on, the brothers that's in the sanctuary, put those hands together. Amen. This morning, amen, for the great I am. Amen. For the Alpha and the Omega. Amen. The beginning and the end. Marvin Sapp said it best. Amen. When others saw the worst in me, amen, God saw the best in me. Amen. Have anybody ever been there? Amen. Don't fool me now. Wave your hand if you've been there. And God saw the best in you when the world saw the worst in you. Come on, one more time. Put those hands together for Jesus, for the great things that he has done and he's getting ready to do in your life. My brothers and my sisters, welcome, amen, to Visitors Chapel, African Methodist Episcopal Church, where we come to give the Lord glory and praise for the great things that he has done. Oh, God, I'm excited this morning for the word. I'm excited to be in the sanctuary, amen, with brothers of God, with men of God, with men of valor, with men that believe in serving our Savior. Amen. To my wife, Carol Fields, amen. On behalf of VCAM, to those watching on Facebook and YouTube Live, amen, VCAM and the church officers, we welcome you and we thank God for you that you did not think it was robbery to come out to share word with us today. And after the sermon, amen, we will be having communion service. So at this time, you can be grabbing your cups and your bread and your juice and everything, getting it ready with your children and your grandma, aunties and uncles and neighbors, and get them all together. Tell them to come over to your house. Amen. Make sure they're vaccinated. Somebody say amen. Amen. All y'all get together and give God some praise. Amen and glory. My brothers and sisters, this morning, amen, we want to go to a very familiar passage of scripture, amen, Brother Tyrone, very familiar passage of scripture, amen, and I'm going to read from, amen, two parallel scriptures this morning, amen, and two parallel scriptures, and the first I'm going to read is my brothers and sisters, is Hebrews, amen, chapter 24, amen, and 25. Hebrews chapter 10, verse 24 through 25. And I'll be reading from, amen, the English Standard Version. Amen. And the Eagle Standard Version, Uncle Bruce reads like this. And it says, and let us consider how to stir up one another to love and good works, not neglecting to meet together, as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another all the more as you see the day drawing near. Is it all right if I read it again? All right. And let us consider how to stir up one another to love and good works, not neglecting to meet together, as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day drawing near. But the New International Version, amen, reads like this. It reads like this in the New International Version. It says, and let us consider how to stir up one another to love and good works, not neglecting, our Lord have mercy, to meet together as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day drawing near. My brothers and my sisters, amen, if I can use a topic for today, the topic will be, amen, why we should go to church. While it is important, Pastor Thomas, for us to be in the house of the Lord. My brothers and sisters, let us go to the throne of grace. Heavenly Father, we thank you, we love you, we magnify you. God, you are worthy to be praised. God, you are magnificent. And God, this morning, God, we can smell the sweet aroma of your Holy Spirit, God. We can smell it now, God. It's even better than grandma cakes on a Sunday morning. God, your sweet aroma of your Holy Spirit, God, is even better than grandma's sweet potato pies on a Christmas day. And God, we ask you right now to allow the sweet aroma of your Holy Spirit, God. We ask it right now, God, that it will permeate, amen, throughout our entire body. Let it saturate us, God, and know that you are our Savior, that you are God, and you can do all things but fail. Holy Spirit, have your way today, God. Have your way today, Holy Spirit, and magnify us, God, in a way, God, that we'll go out and do what the Great Commission said, God, and make disciples. Oh, God, connect us today, God. Connect us to one another through love, through sharing, through commitment, God, through excellence. And God, we'll be so careful to give you a high five up in heaven, God. We'll be so careful, God, to shout from the rooftop. We'll be so careful, God, to stomp our feet and clap our hands and shout hallelujah, because we are part of the body of Christ. And today, God, Holy Spirit, have your way today. The sweet aroma, and I can smell it now, God, of you, God, just the Shekinah glory right now. It's raining down supreme. And today, God, we give you glory and the ultimate praise. In Jesus' magnificent name, let the church say amen. So my brothers and my sisters, amen, when we think about why I should go to church, why Brother McCleary should go to church. My brothers and my sisters, and when we look in the text, amen, at our Hebrew writer, amen, some theologians say that Luke, amen, had a part, amen, in writing, amen, this text. Amen. Theologians have argued and swayed back and forth, like, who is the author of the text? But I believe that all words are inspired by the Holy Spirit. But what I want us to understand today, that Hebrews 10, verse 24 and 25, amen, gives us a glimpse, amen, into why we should go to church. Amen, why we should be in the house of the Lord. My brothers and my sisters, amen, I infer, amen, that that personal contact with other Christians is not merely suggested by the Bible, Brother McDuffie, it is commanded. You say, well, Reverend Fields, what are you talking about? What you mean that it is not merely suggested, but it is commanded? Can I take my time today, Uncle Bruce? Amen, 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 amen. A practical reason for this, Pastor Thomas was giving in verse 24. My brothers and my sisters, relationships with other believers, I want to give you some biblical background. Relationship with other believers, amen, are one way to be encouraged to live out the faith that we proclaim. Am I right about it? We are called to hold fast, through our own spiritual maturity. Oh, Lord, have mercy. And the second thing, amen, is that growing in faith, however, is greatly influenced by having Christian examples around us. Oh, when I'm around Pastor Thomas, I feel connected. Amen. We have a good time. We laugh and we talk and we tease each other. Called good laughter, amen, is good medicine for the soul. Amen. But when I'm around him, I'm around another believer. I'm around somebody that's going to inspire me, encourage me, and motivate me. It's going to tell me, amen. No, Reverend Fields, I know your hands is getting a little tired. I know your arms about to go down. But when I'm around Pastor Thomas, he said, pick those hands up, Pastor. Amen, amen, and just go on just a little while longer. Can somebody say amen? That's why growing in faith, amen, is essential, amen, that we be around other Christians that can greatly influence us. That is why the Great Commission was for the church to make disciples, not merely to talk about Jesus. Oh, I'm in trouble now, Pastor Thomas. Amen, amen. Somebody go outside and fire up the vehicle. Amen, amen. The Great Commission, amen, was for the church to make disciples, not for folk to merely talk about Jesus. Amen, because there's a whole lot of folk who talk about Jesus. Amen, but there's no action behind their words. Amen, amen. There's a whole lot of folk, amen, that say a whole lot of stuff, but there's no action behind their words. So my brothers and sisters, amen, that's why in verse 24 in Hebrews, amen, it commands us to look for opportunities, amen, to inspire others to love and good works. Oh, Lord, have mercy. Amen, amen. And if you look, amen, in the text, amen, this verse, amen, specifically the proves a failure on the part of Christians to meet with other Christians. The Greek term used here, Brother McDuffie, is in kateplos pontes, referring to an abandonment or forsaken. Oh, Lord, have mercy. So if it was in the Greek, it would say abandonment. Amen. Abandonment of Christians or believers, amen, getting together. Amen. In the NSV, it calls it neglecting. Amen. In other words, a failure on my part to meet with Uncle Bruce, amen, in the house of God to inspire Uncle Bruce, amen, to love Uncle Bruce, and to see Uncle Bruce, and Brother McCleary and Brother McDuffie, amen, and Pastor Thomas to do good works. Am I right about it? I just had to give you a little bit of background. But my brothers and sisters, amen, my Lord, have mercy. There was a time in America, amen, when the church was the focal point of the community. Am I right about it? It was, amen, on the community's calendar. Amen. It was the community's culture, and it was on the community's calendar. Families would make it a priority to attend church services and functions every time the church doors were open. Amen. Amen. In Little Moorhaven, I can imagine that in Little Moorhaven and in Wisconsin, in Buffalo, New York, amen, in Fort Lauderdale, Florida, in Uvalde, Georgia, amen, in Wisconsin, in Racine, Wisconsin, on Sunday morning, mothers and fathers got up. Oh, Lord, have mercy. Amen. On a Sunday morning, grandma, a granddaddy, amen, somebody was in the kitchen and the aroma was going throughout the house. Amen. Granddaddy will get up. Daddy will get up. Put on the Sunday best. Amen. Put on, amen, a nice suit with a nice tie. Shoes, black, sharp, clean. Amen. Looking good. Mama will get up. Amen. Put on a nice dress. Hair done. The little girls in the house have on the pigtails. Amen. Pretty little dresses. The boys got on a little white shirt, black tie, and some black shoes. Amen. Everybody went to the house of the Lord and made sure, amen, that when you got up to go into the house of worship, amen, everybody had on their Sunday best. Did anybody know what I'm talking about? Sunday best, amen. And you went to the house of God. And my brothers and my sisters, and the day got started. Amen. When you went to the house, why you go to church? Amen. When you went to the house of God, amen, it started, amen, with Sunday school classes. Amen. You see all your little friends, amen, from school and the little girls in the Sunday school class and passing notes. Hey, do you love me? Yes, no, or maybe so. Will you be my girlfriend? Hey, amen. Just little stuff that you will do in the Sunday school class. Then after Sunday school classes, amen, you will have followed by morning worship services. Yes. Sundays featured. Oh, Lord, have mercy. Several hours of church programming. Most churches also hosted midweek services. Anybody ever been to a midweek service? Like prayer meetings. And not only in the house of God, but they will have prayer meetings in somebody's home. That's what they did, Pastor Tom. That's why church was important. It was a bedrock of the African community. It was a bedrock in the African America diaspora. It was a bedrock in the community. It was a bedrock for civil rights. It was a bedrock for social justice. It was a bedrock for social activism. It was a bedrock to do what is right. Everybody had a beacon. Everybody knew that on Sunday morning, I don't care what you got going on. I don't care if the Dallas Cowboys was playing. I don't care if the Atlanta Falcons was playing. I don't care if the Miami Dolphins was playing. I don't care if the Washington football team was playing. Daddy didn't care. Granddaddy didn't care. You better make your way to the house of God to give God some praise and glory and thank him for the great things that he have done. I will hear my mother. I will hear my aunties. I will hear my cousins, and they will see each other, and they will say, hey, how you doing, Miss Pearl? Miss Pearl said, I'm doing just fine. I'm highly favored and blessed in the Lord. She said, Louise, I grew some cucumbers. I grew some peas. She said, won't you and Robert stop by and pick up your little bushel? Or I can hear, amen, Mr. Arthur Brown telling my daddy, I went fishing the other day, caught me a really good mess. He said, Robert, won't you stop by and pick up your little mess of fish? See, that's why I come into church, is to inspire each other. It is to encourage each other. It is to help each other. It is to build each other up. Can somebody say amen? Oh, yes. I'm done. I'm not done yet, Brother Bruce. Amen. Amen. I love going to church. Amen. Church was so important. It was the pillar of our community. It was the leading focus of what we should be and what we hope to become or who we aspired to be. Yes. I can hear, amen. I used to enjoy hearing my church sing songs by the colored Christian singers. Y'all need to look that up. Amen. Amen. They known as the Jubilee Singers. Amen. From Fisk University. They will sing songs like this, Pastor Thomas. Go down, Moses. Keep me from seeking. Yeah, they will sing songs like that. Go down, Moses, and keep me from seeking. Have any Anybody ever cried out to God when you was in the midnight hour of your crisis and say, God, keep me from seeking. Keep me from falling prey. Keep me from the hands of the enemy, God. Oh, I can hear them singing now. Keep me from seeking. Amen. I can hear them singing songs. Amen. Hear them singing songs from the book, Slave Songs of the United States. They will sing songs like this. No one can hinder me. Oh, Oh, Lord, do y'all remember that song? No one can hinder me. I can hear them singing in the church in Uvalde, Georgia. They will sing songs like Jacob's Ladder or their old Ship of Zion. I can hear them singing songs on a Sunday morning. Amen. Talking about, do not pass me by, oh, gentle Savior. I can hear them singing songs talking about down at the cross where my Savior died. I can hear them singing songs, amen, Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound. I can hear them in the church house singing songs talking about, I'm on the battlefield for the Lord. Oh, God, have mercy. Going to church inspired me. It motivated me. It encouraged me to let me know that I'm not on the battlefield by myself. Oh, but if I keep my hands to the gospel plow. Oh, have anybody ever put their hands to the gospel plow? And the folks will sing those songs. Oh, I feel it in here this morning. Yes, I can hear them singing. But times have changed. Oh, y'all sit down. Times have changed. Most Americans no longer attend church weekly. And many of today are practicing, amen, Christians. Only attend one church service per month. Fighters for the decline in the church attendance are varied, but include the availability of religious content online. The proliferation of other activities for family members on the weekend. When I was coming to church this morning, Pastor Thomas, I noticed that in my neighborhood, everybody was doing something. Some people was cleaning the cars. Some people was mowing the grass. Some people was cutting grass. Some people was weed eating. Some people, amen, was out there on the car working, doing a whole host of things. Amen, and that's okay. Amen, but not forsaking the assembly of the saints together. Listen, some people say, well, I'm too busy. I'm too busy to go to the church. I'm too busy to get up on a Sunday morning. Somebody said to me, amen, that the church is full of hypocrites. Why would I go to a house of God that's full of hypocrites? That's full, well, you go to your job on every day of the week, and your job is full of hypocrites. Amen. When you go to the Dollar General, it's full of hypocrites. It's full of believers. It's full of sinners. It's full of people who are saved by grace and know the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. When you go to school on Tuesday, amen, it's going to be some folk in here who don't know God. It's going to be some folk in there who love God. It's going to be some folk in there who's always messy, but it's going to be some good believers in the schoolhouse. Can somebody say amen? When you go to the grocery store, you don't stop at the grocery store and ask the manager, could you please come to the door? Oh, can I teach for a minute, Brother McDuffie? Can you please come to the door? And the manager comes to the door, and the manager said, well, excuse me, Mr. Manager, excuse me, Miss Manager, is everybody in here saved? Are there any hypocrites in the store today? Because I'm not walking into Walmart. I'm not walking into Food Lion. I'm not walking into Piggly Wiggly until you get all these hypocrites out of this store. And matter of fact, I'm going to call up the governor. I'm not getting on the highway. I'm not even getting on the road. I need the road blocked off so that I can drive to work and not be on the same highway with all those hypocrites, honey. The devil is a lie, honey. We live in this world, but we're not of this world. So it does not matter, amen, who's doing what and who's doing what and when and where. It's about your faith. It's about your walk with Christ. It's about your example. It's about what you are setting. It's about, are you inspiring others? Are you emulating Christian practices? Are you emulating Christian behavior? Are you the paradigm that others should see? When Pastor Thomas go to school as a principal, they see the man of faith. They see the man of God that's not going to compromise his principles. He's going to stand on the faith of God. He's going to stand on that rock. He's going to stand on Jesus Christ. He's going to do his job. But when he go to work every day in the midst of sinners, in the midst of believers, he's going to do what God has asked him to do. Can somebody say amen? Christians, my Lord and my brothers and sisters, why go to church? There are many reasons to attend church service. David said, let us. Lord, have mercy. That's a command, Brother Tyrone. Little Tyrone, that's a command. He said, let us exalt his name together and to give the Lord praise. We go to church. We go to church on a Sunday morning. Amen. Not to look good. Not so folk can see us. Not so folk can high five us. We go to church because, as Romans 12, 1 and 2 said, it's our reasonable service. God has been so good to us. Catch out here, granddaddy, and the deacons playing at the church. Amen. The God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the one who sits high and looks lower, that gave me all the activity of my limbs. Honey, that's why I go to church. I go to church because when I look out of my window, I see the sun. Amen. Amen. And not the S-U-N, as preachers would say, but the S-O-N. I hear the birds chirping. And I hear the sounds of the cars passing by. And I hear, amen, the activity. As Brother McDuffie, when he prays, he says, give me mobility of my limbs. I like that, Brother McDuffie. Instead of activity, Brother McDuffie says, give me the mobility of my limbs. So when I wake up in the morning, I don't feel my best. Anybody ever woke up and not felt their best? And not felt your best? But when I look out the window, and when I look in the mirror and see God's creation, when I look in the mirror and see what God has brought me from, when I look in the mirror, I get motivated, and the fire start burning on the inside of me. It's like that Jeremiah fire. It's like that fire that shut up. I can't turn it off. Then I make my way downstairs, get into my car, got a quarter tank of gas. Matter of fact, it's lower than a quarter of a tank. Who say, oh, but God's been too good to me. I'm going to make it to the house of God to give God some praise and glory, honey. That's why I go to church, honey, because God woke me up this morning. That's why I go to church, because God's been good to me. That's why I go to church, for all the past failures that I've had, and God has rescued me. Pastor Summers told us last week, he said that God is a strong tower and that we can run to him in the time of trouble, honey. How many of you in here ever ran to the strong tower when you was in trouble, honey, and God rescued you? And now you're going to sit at the house watching a football game, watching the Real House of Real Wives of Atlanta, honey. No, I'm going to get up, honey, and look what God has done for me. That's why Marvin Sepp said, God saw the best in me when everybody else saw the worst in me, honey. That's why I'm in the house this morning, honey, because God saw the best in me. Can somebody shout? That's why I go to church. Lord have mercy. Oh, my goodness gracious. That is the church is where we go to get our spiritual batteries recharged. It is a place of comfort for the hurting and a hospital for sinners. In the right kind of church, the Holy Spirit is renewing and refreshing and empowering us and strengthening us on the Christian journey. However necessary this is for a believer's spiritual health, getting reinvigorated is not the primary purpose for going to church. It's essential, but it's secondary. Oh, what do you mean, Reverend Fields? The primary purpose, oh, I need everybody on Facebook and YouTube Live, I need everybody to come in real close. Amen, amen. The primary purpose believers should assemble together, as Hebrew said, is to give God praise and worship. That's why we assemble together, is to give God praise and worship. Amen, that's why we get together. Amen, that's why, amen, I can hear the church people saying that when praises go up, blessings come down. Now, that's not a scripture now, but when praises go up, blessing come down. We are to give God the praise. We are to come and worship God. Have anybody ever been through something and tears was rolling down your face and you came into the house and God was blessing you in a mighty and powerful way? Pastor Thomas and Brother McCleary was leading a worship song and you just started just waving your hands. Your Holy Spirit just started to move in your life and you just started to cry. You don't know why you're crying, but the Holy Spirit just got a hold of you and it just won't leave me alone. Have anybody ever been like that, where the Holy Spirit got a hold of you and it just won't leave you alone? It have you wrapped up, tied up, messed up, flipped up, turn all the way over, but the Holy Spirit won't leave you alone. Can somebody say amen? Oh, Pastor Thomas and Brother McCleary, amen, singing worship songs, singing praising worship songs, and you can't help yourself. Everybody else in the church house say, it don't take all of that. You say, it don't take all of that for you, honey, but let me tell you what God has done for me, honey. Let me tell you, just 2 months ago, I didn't have food in the refrigerator. Just 3 months ago, I didn't have likes of water, honey. But if you know, after they sung that song, that God spoke to my spirit and told me to go to the church house today, and God told me that he was going to bless me, and when I got to the church house, Pastor Thomas and Brother McCleary started singing that song, and my feet got happy, and God began to deal with me and have me all wrapped up, hugged up, booed up, and somebody said God has moved up. Can somebody say amen? Lord have mercy. God will boo you up too. Amen, amen. My brothers and my sisters, an individual believer cannot do this in a vacuum. Sure, we can praise God from a boat or a golf course. We can worship him from a mountaintop. But God created us to be social. The power of praise is magnified when we do it in fellowship with others. David said, let us magnify his name together. Another reason believers should attend church is to avoid error. Oh, Lord, have mercy. If left on our own, it's easy to adopt, Pastor Thomas, false notions or devised doctrines that God's word does not support. Oh, Lord, have mercy. You got to be careful. That's another reason why we go to church. Amen. I know in the military, we used to call them barracks lawyers. Amen. You get in a little trouble. Anybody ever heard of the barracks lawyers? Amen. Those who served in the army, this is what this means. You go back, you get in some trouble, you go to your room. Everybody in the army had a stereo. Everybody in the army had a VCR and a TV. And everybody would be in the room playing dominoes and spades. And they say, man, if I were you, I'll go down there and cuss Sergeant First Class Thomas, this soon to become Chief Warrant Officer Thomas, I tell him a piece of my mind. Screw him, man. And then you get that courage, that liquid courage. You get that in your system. Get down there with Sergeant First Class, Chief Warrant Officer, Senior Chief Warrant Officer Thomas, going off with your mouth. Amen. Going off with Platoon Sergeant Avery McCleary, talking about what you going to do, what you ain't going to do. And next thing you know, you find yourself standing in the commanding officer office, one rank lower, loss of money, extra duty, stuff in your records because you listen to barracks lawyers. Well, there's barracks lawyers in the Christian faith. Can somebody say amen? Amen. Totally taking text out, totally taking spiritual text out of context. Talking about the Bible says that what goes on in the dark will come to light. That's why they got in trouble. Well, the Bible does say that. Amen. But God has hid some stuff in your life that he's never showed anybody. Why? Because you did a 180. Amen. You did a 180 and changed your life, honey. Well, the Bible says, well, that's why when folk go out there, when praises go up, blessings come down. No, honey, that's not a scripture, honey. That is just a call and response that we say to one another. That's why you got to be careful, amen, who's teaching you, who's leading you. Oh, well, the Bible said that those who drink gonna go to hell. That's not what the Bible said. The Bible says in Galatians 5, in verse 19 to 21, he said, don't be a drunkard. Now, if you got alcohol in your system and alcohol runs in your family, and it has destroyed your life, then I desire that you never touch it at all, because I want you to live by faith and walk by sight and live by faith. Can somebody say amen? So that's why you can't just be running around, as Sager the Entertainer would say, all willy-nilly listening to everything that everybody got to say. Everybody is not trained. Everybody don't know God. Everybody don't love God. You got to be careful who you listening to. It'll mess you up. It'll have you throwing away your good music. Somebody say amen. It'll have you throwing away your good music. Oh, preach to yourself, Reverend Field, because you threw away your good music. It'll have you throwing away your temptations. It'll have you thinking that you can't do nothing. It'll have you thinking that you can't go to a party. It'll have you thinking that you can't go on vacation. It'll have you thinking that when you go on your anniversary that you got to play Amazing Grace, How Sweet the Sound. It'll have you all messed up. It'll have you all convoluted. It'll have you all discombobulated, honey. Oh, but God loves when I go for my anniversary, and I'm playing some Luther Vandross, talking about here and now. I can hear Tyrone telling Keisha, I love you here and now, and I'ma love you faithfully. I can hear Pastor Thomas whispering in Arlene there, talking about I love you, talking about today is our anniversary. I can hear Brother Meek, Brother Thomas. I can hear Brother Bruce looking at Mama Candy last night and telling her always and forever. Oh, Lord, have mercy. God said we own something. God desires that we love each other. But you listen to folks who always giving you spiritual inaccuracies. Have anybody ever met somebody? That's why it's important when you go to church. That church is important. That's where you get good doctrine. That's where you get good sound preaching. That's where you get good sound living. That's when we talk about faith, love, but we also talk about sin. We also talk about heaven and hell. We also talk about how you should live your life according to the word of God. That's why Bible study is important. That's where we come and we hear the word of God. We can raise our hands and ask Pastor Thomas questions and say, Pastor Thomas, can you elaborate on that text? Can you give me some of that seminary training that you got and give me just a little bit more, amen, so I can build, oh Lord, have mercy, so I can build my faith. Oh God, have mercy. That's why I go to church. So my brothers and my sisters, why I go to church is so that God can love me. And the third reason, this leads us to the third purpose. Believers should gather regularly. None of us have been saved just for our own sake. As disciples of Jesus Christ, we are under command to spread the gospel to others. Going to church equips us spiritually through our praises and mentally through what we learn. To carry out the great work of evangelism. Can somebody say amen? Which is a mandate for every believer. Not everyone is called to be an evangelist. But every believer is called to evangelize. Oh, my Lord, have mercy. Amen, amen. Not everyone is called to be, amen, an evangelist. But every believer is called to evangelize. We are supposed to reach out to others by our example and with our words. Am I right about it? To tell them of God's plan for salvation. Being in church regularly gives us the tools, Brother McCleary, to do so. Missing church means that we're missing out on the fullness of what God has to offer us. Oh, attending church, amen, feels good. Attending church with sinners and unbelievers feels good. That's why the Bible said it rains on the just and the unjust. Oh, God, just have your way today. Attending church should be the highlight of every Christian's week. I can't wait the Sunday. Dragon, I can't wait the Sunday so I can get into the house of God and I can lift up his holy name and I can keep this fire burning on the altar all night long. I can't wait till I get there. Brother McDuffie said, Pastor, where you at? He said, Brother, I don't pull up on a sidewalk, sideways, and jump out the car. The car still running, Brother McDuff. Can somebody turn it off for me? Pastor Thomas getting ready to preach, and I can't miss this sermon. Can somebody run outside real quick, close my doors, and turn off my car, because I had to make my way to the house of God to hear this word from this man of God, because without the preacher, how can they hear? Oh, Lord, have mercy. So my brothers and my sisters, we gather as believers, amen, because when the devil comes after us, with one affliction after another. But the Bible says, it tells us in Hebrews chapter 10, verse 24 and 25. It tells us, Brother McCleary, it said, and let us consider how to stir up one another to love and good works. Is that what the Bible says? Not neglecting to meet together, as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another all the more as you see the day drawing near. So my brothers and my sisters, I come out to tell somebody, today is the day that the Lord is getting ready to pour you out a blessing that you have room enough not to receive. Can I take my time, Brother Bruce? The saints of God have come together because we know that many of the affliction of the righteous, but the Lord deliver us from them all. And that is why they could see in Psalm 23, yea, though I walk through the valley of death, honey, that's why I come to church sometimes, because it feels like I'm walking through a valley of death. But when I come into the house of God, I can see my brothers and sisters telling me to hold on just a little while longer. When I come into the house of God, I can hear my brothers and sisters telling me that I can make it. When I come into the house of God, I can hear my brothers and my sisters telling me that I walk by faith and not by sight. But if I was at the house, I couldn't get that word. If I was in my living room, I could get that word. But the Bible tells us to forsake not the assembly of the saints together. But when I walk into the house of God, when I walk into God's house, not feeling my best, I can hear Brother McCleary. I can hear Mama Pat. I can hear Sister Naomi telling me that I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. I can hear the words of the Savior telling me to hold on just a little while longer. And when I don't feel like going, I can hear Sister Zakisha telling me, because he lives, I can face tomorrow. That's what I get when I come into the house of God. That's what the brothers do for me. That's what the sisters do for me when I come into the house of God. Can somebody say, that's why I go to church? That's why I go to church, so I can be with my brothers and my sisters. Believers come to church to encourage each other. Whatever it is, we are here to encourage each other. Whatever it is, we're here to encourage each other to go through the hurt and the pain, to go through the heartaches, to go through the disappointments, honey. That's why the Bible says that we should be renewed. Renew my faith. And that's why when I come into the house of God, when I'm feeling down when I'm feeling low, I can hear little Tyrone tell me that I'm more than a conqueror. Come on, Pastor Fields, you got this. I know it's getting a little rough. I know it's getting a little tougher, but you got this. We are more than conquerors. We are not quitters. We are winners in Jesus Christ. Can somebody shout yes? I feel like preaching. I feel like giving God some praise. I love coming to church, honey, so I can see my brothers and my sisters. So I can love my brothers and sisters. So my brothers and sisters can love me. Can somebody shout? That's why I come to church. That's why I come to church. It's to give God praise and glory. It's to inspire others. That's why. I know it's hypocrites. I know it's sinners. I know it's mean people in the church. I know it's nasty people in the church. But guess what? They don't dictate my individual salvation. But this Jesus that we serve, this Mary's little baby. Can I move over here, Brother McDuffie? The bright and the morning star. The lily of the valley. The Alpha and the Omega. The beginning and the end. This Jesus that we serve. This Jesus. That the disciples said, what manner of man is this that can make the wind and the sea obey him? This Jesus that put back on a man's ear. This Jesus that made the deaf hear and the blind see. This Jesus that told us, amen, that we were like sheep headed to the slaughter. But he saw it and he was moved with compassion. Bless all the meek, so they shall inherit the earth. This Jesus, who gave us the greatest sermon of all time, gave us the greatest sermon, the Sermon on the Mount. This same Jesus, who was crucified, hung on a cross, beaten all night long, mocked, laughed at, pierced in the side, Pastor Thomas, scratched wide. They hung him and they scratched him wide, laughed at him. Oh, this same Jesus. So I love my people so much. I'm going to redeem mankind back to me. Easily I can get off this cross. Easily I can get off this cross and handle my business. But because of Jack, but because of Pastor Thomas, but because of Uncle Bruce, but because of little Tyrone and Big Tyrone and Brother McCleary, and because of the VCAP church family, they are going to fall prey to the victim. And I got to stay here and serve my purpose so that I can redeem mankind back to me. There's somebody today that said, Reverend Fields, now I understand. I go to church not for translucent lights, not for nice cafes, not for coffee centers, not for the best Wi-Fi in the city, not for all flashing lights and the pastor walking around with Air Jordans and skinny jeans, amen, and stuff like that. No, I go to church so I can get a word from the Lord. I have no problem with wearing tennis shoes. I got some on right now. But when I was taught in seminary by my parents that the pulpit should be respected, that this is holy ground. Somebody say holy ground. Amen. This is holy ground. And so when I come to church, I have that reverence for God. I have that respect for God. You don't just show up at your job any old kind of way. Amen. When there's a dress code, they tell you to show up a certain way. The Bible said come as you are, not like you want to. Oh, I'm getting in trouble. Amen. Restart the car, Brother McDuffie. I'm about to get up out of here. Restart it real quick. Amen. But come not like you want to. Amen. But come as you are. So I want us to understand that the church is a place where we all can come and laugh and cry and build each other up, motivate each other, tell each other about new jobs that's out there on the horizon, tell somebody about some new scholarships that just came out that Brother McCleary knows about, or Brother McDuffie knows, but I have no idea about. But when we come into the house of God, we can put it on the bulletin board. We can pass it out to everybody else. Pastor Thomas can say they're hiring 22 teachers. Amen. That's something, man. All puentes. Y'all need to go and hire and get hired. We can share news. We can share the good news. Somebody say amen. Oh, but when we come into God's house, the house that's filled with blessings that'll blow your mind, that is why we go to church. Your individual salvation belonging unto you. So I'm going to lean forward right quick. And I'm going to ask everybody who don't know Jesus, under the sound of my voice, to repeat after me the sinner's prayer. Romans 10, verse 9. I believe in my own heart, and I confess with thy own mouth that Jesus Christ, amen, died on the cross. I confess with thy own mouth that on the third day that Jesus Christ got up with all power in the palm of his hand. I believe that Jesus sit on the right hand of God. I believe that Jesus can redeem me of my sins. I believe that Jesus is the Alpha and Omega. I believe that Jesus is the author and finisher of my faith. And finally, I want you to understand that if you have said that, you have accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and as your Savior, because the Bible declares that whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. You have accepted Jesus Christ. Well, now you say, Reverend, I don't have a church home. I need some good teaching. I need some sound doctrine. I need good preaching, good teaching from the pulpit. I need good teaching in Bible study. Well, guess what? You are coming to the right place. If you just put your comments in there, Pastor Thomas, Brother McDuffie, Brother McCleary, Uncle Bruce, somebody will get back with you, and they will tell you how you can join virtually, how you can join. And when you come into God's house, it is going to be awesome. If there be one today, you say, well, Reverend, I want to join Visitors Chapel. I'm already saved, filled with the Holy Ghost. I love going to church. I'm new in the city, and I want to find me a place to worship. Well, this is the place. This is the place for you to come. A God-fearing church, a loving church, a church that's got good teaching, good sound doctrine, good leaders, good church leaders, those who have fallen from the faith and those who know who God is that can redeem us back unto him. But if you're looking, as I always say, for the perfect church, I'm sorry, Pastor Thomas, this ain't it. This ain't it. Then you need to go down to somewhere else. But you're looking for somebody that's going to follow God's commands, that's going to do sound teaching, that's going to have sound doctrine, that's going to respect the pulpit, that's not going to fleece the flock, that's not going to run around with the church members, that's not going to run around in the city, that's going to love folk, that's not going to mess up church folk money, that you can come to the church house and check where every cent of your money is going, and my church office will show you where your money is going and show you the bank account. If you want to see what we're doing and you want to offer ideals of how we can grow spiritually, maturely, how we can grow and get better so we can do better work for the kingdom, your ideals are welcome. Your ideals are needed, and this is the place for you to come and serve. And look at somebody and say, they're welcome. You're welcome here. So my brothers and my sisters, God is awesome. And God is good. And God is good all the time. Forsake not the assembly of the saints together. Enklite pontes. In the Greek stands for abandonment. Never abandon forsaking of the assembly of the saints together. My brothers and sisters, I'm going to ask Brother Tyrone to come. I got some good news. Before we do that, we're going to go and share in our communion service. Is that all right? Okay. Brother McCleary, Pastor Thomas, can you just sing a little bit? Can you come down and just sing a little bit of a communion song, one or two verses or something real nice before we go into communion? Amen. Will you come and just sing something? I know the Lord got something in your spirit. Amen. That's how they do that in a little more heaven. You got to always be ready. They ain't just known for bass fishing. They known for loving the Lord too. Amen. Amen. They're good people down there. Amen. I can tell why. Because he's here with us. There's good people down in Moorhaven. So Pastor Tom, won't you sing something for us before we partake in the Lord's Supper?
I know it was the blood. I know it was the blood. I know it was the blood for me. Well, one day when I was lost, Jesus died upon the cross, and I know it was the blood for me. I know it was the blood, oh Lord, hey, I know it was the blood, hey Lord, hey, I know it was the blood for me.
Yes, he did. Yeah.
They hung him on the cross.
They hung him.
They hung him on the cross for me. Well, one day when I was lost, Jesus died upon the cross. Child, I know it was the blood for now he's coming back again.
Yes, he is, y'all.
He's coming back again, Lord. He's coming back again for me. Well, one day when I was lost, Jesus died upon the cross. Well, now I know it was the blood for me. Oh, Lord, yeah. I know it was the blood.
Yes,
it was.
I know it was the blood.
Yes, it was.
I know it was the blood for me.
Lord, have mercy. Good gracious alive. Oh, my God. My goodness, my gracious. Oh, my. Hey, that's what Bishop Mean will say. He will say, my goodness, my gracious. I know it was the blood. Anybody know it was the blood? Put your hands together if you know it was the blood. Amen. Come on. Come on. Don't fool me now. Put your hands together and tell me. And tell me it was nothing but the blood. So, my brothers and my sisters, today we have come to break bread. We have come, my brothers and sisters, to share in the Lord's Supper. We have come to share in God's communion into the Lord's Supper. The elements have already been consecrated by the pastor, and we're going to break bread today with each other. So I'm going to ask everybody to grab their bread and hold it in their hand. Get it now. Hold it in your hand. And let us break bread together. The Bible said that when Jesus took the bread, the Bible said that he broke it, little Tyrone. And he said he gave it to the disciples. And he said, take it and eat it. And much as you shall eat it, he said, do this in the remembrance of me. Uh-huh. Give you time to grab your juice, your communion cup. And then the Bible said, likewise, after supper, Brother McCleary, they said he took the cup. And they said that when he took the cup, Uncle Bruce, he said he gave it to the disciples, and he said, take it and drink it. He said, as much as ye shall drink it, he said, do this in the remembrance of me, that it may preserve your soul and your body to everlasting life. Jesus Christ, I am a sinner that's saved by grace. I thank you that you have changed my life and had me do a 180 and taught me to live right. So, Jesus, I lift this cup, and I thank you for saving a wretch like me. And I thank you, God, for turning my life around. I take it, I drink it, and I'm glad. Amen. Take your cup and drink of the Lord's Supper. And as much as you shall drink it, take it and drink it at this time. And as much as you shall drink it, this do in remembrance of him, that it may preserve your soul and your body until everlasting life. Let us pray. Father, we thank you. We love you that we have partaken the Lord's Supper. God, we thank you that you have allowed us to see another day. God, you are thankful, as my good friend Pastor Tumbles will say, to hear the glad tidings of your faith in your word. Oh, God, elevate us today. Motivate us today, God, that we have partaken in this consecrated service, or partaken in the Lord's Supper, or partaken of your bread, or partaken in your shed blood on Calvary, God. So we ask that you will continue to motivate us, elevate us, continue to empower, and continue to equip us, God, to go out and serve this great country and to be servant leaders, God, not those wishing to be served, God, but for those who want to be servant leaders. God, we ask you right now in the name of Jesus Christ that you cleanse our hearts, our minds, and our souls. And as David said, and renew the right spirit within us, God. Let us have a way. Let us know your way. Let us let your word saturate in our hearts, God. And let us understand, God, that we're not going to abandon coming to church. We're not going to neglect coming to church. We're not going to neglect or abandon meeting together with the believers in God's house to be inspired, motivated, and encouraged. And we'll give you the ultimate glory and the ultimate praise in Jesus' magnificent name. All God's believers said amen. God bless you. Amen. Ask Brother McCleary, will you come? I'm not Brother McCleary, but Brother Tyrone, will you come real quickly? Then after Brother Tyrone come, then I'm going to share some good news, amen, about next week. Amen. We're going to come on, Brother McDuffie. Amen. He's walking out here like a church officer. That's how church officers walk, Pastor Thomas. Amen. They walk like they in charge. See, that's why you walk when you got initials behind your name, like licensed professional counselor. They got a different bounce. They got a different walk. Amen. My dear brother, amen, Stuart McDuffie, licensed professional counselor, credentialed mental health provider, my good friend in Visitors Chapel, our church officer, Stuart Tyrone McDuffie Jr.
Good morning, VCAM family. What a powerful word we heard this morning from our pastor, why we go to church. And as pastor said, there's hypocrites everywhere, but we still get up and go to work. We still get up and go to school. and we still get up and go in all those stores. So then we all should be getting up and praising the Lord on Sundays. As the pastor said in that powerful, powerful, motivational, inspirational, inspiring word this morning. And I thank you for that word, Pastor. But I got a few announcements here. And the first announcement I want to make is tell you about our Zoom Bible study, which we have every Wednesday, 6 p.m. Mountain Standard Time on Zoom. And if you want to be a part of our Zoom Bible study, all you have to do is send an email to vcamalpaso915@yahoo.com. And that link will get sent to you. And you click on that link and come right on into our Bible study as we continue studying the book of James. And we're having a great time in doing so. I also want to tell you about our ministries. We have our Feeding God's People ministry, and we have our VCAM Curbside Prayer. We offer both those ministries every second Saturday of the month from 10 a.m. to 12 p.m. Mountain Standard Time. You don't have to get out of your vehicle. You don't have to get out of your car. All you have to do is drive up, roll down your window, open up the trunk of your car, and we can put some non-perishable food items in there. And then if you want prayer, pull on up, roll down your window, and make your prayer request. If you want to call somebody who you know is in need of prayer, give them a call. And one of our reverends or one of our stewards or one of our church officers, we'd be more than glad to pray for you and your family or whatever person that's in need or whatever type of prayer you want that morning. And so as always, to support our ministries, we couldn't do it without your help. And we always graciously accept all of your donations. And we're so appreciative that you take time to donate to us, because we're doing the right things with your money, and we're making sure your money go where you requested to go. So if you'd like to give to our ministries, you can do so by going to Givelify, givlify.com. But when you go there, you have to type in Visitors Chapel, AME, El Paso, Texas, okay, to make sure you donate to Visitors Chapel, okay? And you can also donate by Cash App. That's $, that's VCAM, that's El Paso 915, and you'll see a picture of our church. Now, when you get to either one of those ways of giving, all you do is go into the memo section and say, I'd like my donation to go to Feeding God's People Ministry, or I'd like it to be a general offering, or I'd like it to go to the trustees, and we'll make sure that your funds will get there. As always, I want to thank the pastor and his wonderful, beautiful First Lady for giving me the opportunity to always speak and give you announcements here at VCAM. And the pastor will be coming back on with some closing remarks. And thank you again for having me, and God bless you all.
Amen. Thank you, amen, Stuart McDuffie. Thank you so much. Amen. Thank you, Pastor Thomas, for standing in the gap. I told y'all, Little Mohaven, they known for more than just bass fishing. I'm telling you, them brothers down there, they can sing and preach, and they are good people and good leaders. Amen. Little Mohaven, amen. Amen. They are blessed. And down in Fort Lauderdale, Florida, I know, see, my cousins are down there, Brother Mike. I know they can sing down there. I know they can get down in Fort Lauderdale, Florida. Amen. Thank y'all for standing in the gap this morning. But my brothers and my sisters, we have been out of the church, amen, for a while now. I believe, Pastor Thomas, I can be corrected. But I believe last time that we may have been together may have been late February or early March of 2020, around that time. Well, we know that the Delta variant, there have been a couple of cases here in El Paso, and things are happening. But what we are going to do, amen, on April the 8th, amen, April the 8th. Somebody say April the 8th. April the 8th at 10 o'clock Mountain Standard Time. On April the 8th, August the 8th, August the 8th. Amen. Why am I saying April the 8th? Amen. Little Tyrone, my armor bearer, he kept telling me, putting up four. He was putting up four, y'all. So he put up four. I went with January, February, March, April. Amen. No, he didn't do that, y'all. Amen. I was just messing up. Amen. Amen. It is August the 8th. August the 8th at 10 a.m. Mountain Standard Time. Can I say it one more time, Brother McClifford? Can somebody shout August the 8th? August the 8th. I wonder why nobody shout when I say April the 8th. They say, Pastor, we're not shouting with that. But August the 8th at 10 a.m. Mountain Standard Time, we are going to be having a soft opening. We're going to have a soft opening. We're going to come into the house of God. Amen. We have met as a church body. We have voted as a church body. We have come up with some guidelines as a church body. Amen. And we're going to have those guidelines and procedures in place. So spread the word. On August the 8th at 10 a.m. Mountain Standard Time, we are going to be in the sanctuary. So I need for you to come out to the house of God. Amen. It is the second Sunday of the month. So the second Sunday of the month is our dress down Sunday. So we're going to keep it with that theme. On the second Sunday of the month, that is our dress down Sunday, August the 8th, 10 a.m. Mountain Standard Time. Soft opening at Visitors Chapel African Methodist Episcopal Church. So spread it on Facebook. We got the flyer already to go into motion. We're going to send it to you, put it out there, amen, and send it out to the radio station. You got friends in different places or whatever that can help us get out the word, soft opening. Then after we meet on August the 8th and we see how things goes, and then the church body will come back. And the church body will come back and we'll look at how we did for the soft opening and whether we need to make some changes or whether we should continue according to the CDC guidelines and the direction of the city and all of the health officials. But August the 8th, I want to see your face. On August the 8th, Stuart McDuffie and Pastor Thomas, I want to see your face in God's house on August the 8th at 10 a.m. Mountain Standard Time in the pews while we are shouting and clapping and singing hallelujah, amen, and shouting the glad tidings of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. I need y'all to come out. Somebody say come out. I need y'all to come out. August the 8th, 10 a.m. Mountain Standard Time. Amen. Come into God's house where we can give him some praise and glory and we can worship his name. Amen. Let's stand to our feet. Let's leave God's house, but never from his presence. My brothers and my sisters, once again, August the 8th, 10 a.m., Mountain Standard Time. Soft opening. And it's the second Sunday. It's called Dress Down Sunday. Put on your nice T-shirt, nice khaki jeans, nice polo shirt, nice slacks, some nice kicks, as they will say, some nice Sunday shoes. Come on out here looking good, talking good, praising the Lord good as we get together and to be in the presence of our Savior. And we're not going to forsake not the assembly of the saints together. Is that all right with you all? Now may the grace of God, now may the sweet communion of his Holy Spirit, now may it rest rule hence now and forevermore. Let all God's people say amen, amen, and amen. And as we say here at VCAM, if God can't do it, and if you do it right,
God will bless it right.
Let God bless it right for you all week long. Amen. We love you. Carol loves you. I love you. VCAM loves you. But God loves you best. Have a blessed week in the Lord. And we'll see you once again on Wednesday night at 6 p.m. Mountain Standard Time, where we listen and learn the life lessons and leadership of Brother James. And also on August the 8th at 10 a.m. Mountain Standard Time, please be in the house of God. Don't meet me there, beat me there. In Jesus' name, amen.
Well, I would never go back. I was blind to the truth, didn't know what I had. I was running, I was searching, but every place I turned for healing left me more broken than the last. Take me back to the place that feels like home, to the people I can depend on, to the faith that's in my bones. Take me back to a preacher and a verse where they've seen me at my worst, to the love I had at first. I wanna go to church. Trying to walk on my own, but I wound up lost. Now I'm making my way to the foot of the cross. It's not a trophy for the winners, it's a shelter for the sinners, and it's right where I belong. Take me back in my bones. Take me back to a preacher and a verse where they've seen me at my worst, the faith that's in my bones. Take me back to a preacher and a